This presentation about the role of OCT to detect glaucoma progression. The detection of glaucoma progression with OCT remains a challenge. There is no gold standard agreement upon which method is the one to use. In this presentation, I'm going to show you the four common methods found among different machines to detection of glaucoma progression. The first one considered glaucoma changes are those exceeding age-related structural changes and exceeding test-retest variability. Age loss over time in the retinal fiber layer between 1/3 to 1/2 micron per year, in the spectralis around 0.36 micron per year. For the ganglion cell of the macula, spectralis, again, it is less than 0.5 micron per year. So as we do OCT regularly every 1 year, so changes are less than 1 micron. So age is not a considerable factor for the. What about test-retest fluctuation? In the ZEISS, this study shows that the average retinal fiber layer thickness change is 5 micron. For the quadrants, it's between 7 to 9 microns. For the hour, it's between 10 to 12 microns. Another study for the OptiView showed that the average change of the retinal fiber layer is 5. For the ganglion cell complex, it's 5. For the retinal fiber layer superior or inferior, it's between 9 and 8. For the Heidelberg, again, the whole retinal fiber layer thickness change is around 5, and the ganglion cells of the macula is around 5. So as you notice here, the 5 rule, that if you have changes higher than 5, then most probably you have glaucoma progression. You can let the machine calculate it for you. If, and this is in the ZEISS, if there is changes behind test-retest normal variation, if it occurs once, you have it in the yellow color. If the changes occur twice, you have it in the red color. Again, another example. The rule of 5 for detection of glaucoma depends on what we have just mentioned. Repeated testing in healthy patients conducted over a short interval, the peripapillary retinal fiber layer thickness showed the limits of test retest variability to be slightly below 5 microns. When an eye showed a loss of 5 microns or more, this is an evidence of progression. But recent work suggested that the rule of 5 has poor specificity. It will lead to many high false positives over the time. For example, in this study, the authors carried out the study on 82 control eyes and 300 glaucoma subjects. OCT was done twice per year for 5 years. It was found that the cumulative probability of false positive in the control group is around 25%, while in the glaucoma group it around 40%. So the authors concluded that around 15% are the real change in the glaucoma group, while the remaining would be found by mistake at those in the control group. Some other authors suggest that changes in the mean retinal fiber layer thickness to be at least 20 microns. This was based on being double the reproducibility error of the device, and also they suggested that the changes should be in 2 of 3 consecutive follow-up scans. Another parameter that can help if we depend on change map. Here in the glaucoma progression analysis of dice, this is the first 2 base test and this is the current test. So the software compared the changes of this current test to the baseline. If there is fluctuation higher than the test-retest variability, then you have this zone in yellow. If on the next 4th test the same changes were found, then they will be shown in red. So we can just keep the data of the patient and the machine will do the comparison, and we can see the results in case of the nerve fiber layer changes here and the change map. Or in case of the ganglion cells, you can again see it here comparing the current with the first base 2 and again the following one. And changes appearing for the one time will be in yellow, and twice it will be in red. You have to keep in mind if you are examining a patient glaucoma probability progression that it should be a reliable test. For example, here the sensitivity of this test is less than accepted, and also this one and this one, there was no registration. Registration means that the image was tilted so that it fits to the baseline one. So we are not sure about the results here because of low signal strength and there is no registration. So this is not acceptable. This is an example that one of my colleagues consider this patient to be progressive, comparing changes here with the second one. But he missed that this one is of a very low signal quality, and that's why this is a false thickness. Again, in the Heidelberg, comparison of the thickness between one visit and the next can be done by the machine, and the difference can be plotted out. This can be done for the whole thickness of the layers of the retina, or can be done in a specific of the different layers of the retina. And change map will show us changes between 2 tests. A third method is to check the changes of the whole retinal fiber layer thickness profile, as it is shown here in the glaucoma progression analysis of dice. We have base 1, base 2, this is the first 2 tests, and C is the current test. Again, this is the most recent one, this is C, and these 2 baselines are here. And if any difference between found, then the area of difference will be colored. It can be colored yellow if this change occurs once, and it will be colored red if this difference is seen twice. So this is the clue. If you have yellow mark, means that the change between the current and the 2 baseline is found. And if it's red, it means that the changes of the current was found in previous and compared to the first 2 base. So if you have a yellow mark, means that you need for a follow-up to confirm changes. If it is red, so you are sure that it happened before and the current the second time to appear. Keep in mind this also, this machine get this violet appearance. This violet means that possible increase in thickness. How come? This is a default in the technology that sometimes you can have increase in thickness. So the bottom line, just be careful of accepting everything of the machine. Another consideration, because we are comparing with the baseline, sometimes you can change the baseline instead of having the same baseline. If there is marked changes at one time, you can change your baseline so follow-up can be compared to a more recent location, not the original one. In the OptiView, again, here the whole nerve fiber layer circumference, one time, another time, and a difference if exceeding the test retest level, then it is marked. Lastly, for the progression, there is a regression line plot. Here, this is an example of the regression line for the whole thickness of the retinal fiber layer, and this is for the superior half, and this is for the inferior half of the retinal fiber layer. Again, in another print, this is the whole thickness. This is the superior retinal fiber layer. This is the inferior retinal fiber layer. This is the cup disc ratio. As you can see here, B1 and B2 are the base 2 test. C is the current. C is in blue, so the line in blue is the current. And you can see here the area comparing this part in the superior circumference to the baseline, there is changes, and these changes occur twice, so we have the mark here in red. What about this gray zone? As you can see here, the numbers here, the rate of change is 0.01. plus minus 0.007. This is the 95 confidence interval. Here the slope is minus 2.43, and the confidence interval is plus minus 8 microns over this number. What's meant by the 95 confidence interval? It means that if we repeat the test 100 times, every time you are going to have another slope. So 95% we are sure that the result will be inside this gray zone, or actually inside these limits. Again, this is the slope and this is the 95% interval. Again, in the OptiView, we have similar results. This is for the retinal fiber layer, and this is for the ganglion cell complex. The gray zone is the 95 confident interval. As you can see here, we have a slope of minus 1.94, and the confidence interval, it is here between minus 3 and minus 0.87. So the slope is here, but if we repeat the test so many times, we are 95% sure that we are going to have slope between these two extremities. So this is the result we have this time, and statistically, if we repeat the test 100 times, 95% we are sure that the result, the slope, should be between these two intervals. Now, if you have the patient tested three times, this will be the regression line. If you have another fourth test, then the regression line, this is the rest, the fourth result, the regression line is different. One further examination, this is the one, this is the second regression line, this is another regression line, more examination, a regression line varies. So each time you have another result, the regression line will be a little bit down or a little bit up. Why I'm saying that? Because so far we don't have a limit for the regression line. If we meet it, we say that this is a case of progression. I want you to read these few lines of the manual of the Zeiss machine. It's written here that the machine does not evaluate progression of glaucoma, which can only be assisted through evaluating changes of other clinical factors like optic nerve appearance, like field changes. The software only refers to changes in the retinal nerve fiber layer assisted by statistical analysis. That's all. But the machine does not diagnose progression. So the bottom line, we have different clues that may help us in detection of progression, but keep in mind that the changes we are talking about, they are something that is statistically significant, but it may or may not be clinically significant. And we need to correlate changes with the other tests like perimetry and IOP. The rate of loss, the location of detection of loss, the age of the patient, the stage of the disease, and other clinical factors should be evaluated for clinical decision. Thank you for your attention.